the Gospel according to Luke. And we will try to read as much of it as possible in class. And so what we ask you to do is, if you have an NAB, New American Bible, which is the version that's in the lectionary that we hear at Sunday Mass, or weekday Masses, things like that, I'll ask you to do some reading, or else my voice will go and I'll not make it through the 2.5 hours. It's just constantly being prompted. Okay? But you also know that I always get a bunch of background. This time it'll be a lot less background. But I need to make sure that you all understand certain basic things. And if you've been with me before, you will have heard these things before. So this will be a refresher for you. And if you've never been in my class before, you may never have heard these things before, but that's okay too. You need to be introduced to them. So we're all starting out on the same playing field. All people get this thing. Okay? So let's start talking about this. What did I do with my markers? You all know that we have such a thing as the Bible, right? And in that Bible, there's both a New Testament and an Old Testament. Okay? So first pop quiz question. How many books are there in the New Testament? 27. Okay. Of these 27 books in the New Testament, four of them are called Gospels, aren't they? So we have four Gospels. The word gospel in English comes from two old English words, go spell. Right, you see, you got gospel from that, okay? Good spell. He says it's about some good news. Glad tidings. So gospel means good news. In the ancient world, the Greek word that we get go spella and eventually gospel from is evangelion. Okay? Which meant good news. It was an oral proclamation of something good that was about to happen. It would bring joy to people. The emperor has a son. No, the king has a son. Good news. The birth of Caesar Augustus was gospel in Greek. Good news. The emperor is coming next on the Ides of April, and we're going to have chariot races. Good news. Okay. There's going to be free bread. Good news. So it was all these oral proclamations of good news in the ancient world. That's what evangelion meant. Notice we get the word evangelist and stuff from that film. Evangelical. Okay, those kinds of words. So we have these four gospels. Eventually, in Paul's writing, Paul will say, remember the gospel that I told you about when I was there? The good news of Jesus Christ. Okay. Remember from your study of the Old and New Testament with me, Paul's letters were written first. There were no written Gospels yet. Okay. When Paul writes the first letter to the Thessalonians around 50 AD. Okay. But anyway, eventually these things get written down. And eventually when you ask people, what's a Gospel? They'll say, well, that's those written stories about Jesus that we call Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, whenever you see something in a book and either the name spelled out or an abbreviation like Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and have a line under it, they're not talking about the person called Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They're talking about the gospel, the book called Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, named after the evangelist who supposedly wrote it. Now, what happened was we realized after a period of time that Matthew, Mark, and Luke all had the same perspective on Jesus' story. There was something strange about John's gospel that was different. Okay? And so we give a particular name to these gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And we all know from our other courses that that name is, oh, welcome, Holy Rosary!
Late.
Come in! Luke's coming in! Now, you all know that Sister Kathy makes you register things, whether or not you want to or not. So to make her happy, you know I don't want to hurt her back. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke have a particular name because they both all have the same perspective. And we call them the Synoptic Gospels. Synoptic comes from two Greek words. Optically, go to the optician, see, okay? And syn, with or alongside. Synoptic. That comes from the Greek. The Latin would be perspective. They all have the same perspective. They all can be lined up. Sometimes there are books where you actually line them up, the same stories from all three, and see how they're the same and how they were different. Now, over the course of time, in the early church, the Gospel of Matthew was valued probably the most because it could be used like a catechism for instruction. And we'll find that next year when I teach Matthew more about how that works. But it was very, very important. It was also the only Gospel which in Greek had the word ekklesia in it. Ecclesia, church. So the church was at first gravitated to Matthew because it talked about a church, okay? And that kind of a thing, okay? Mark, it's shorter, it's darker, it doesn't have a lot of those wonderful parables in it and everything else. It must be an abridgment of Matthew or whatever, okay? Luke, people like Luke, right? Why? Infancy narratives, huh? The great parables, the prodigal son, the good Samaritan. It's a beautiful thing. So people were gravitated towards Luke. And so for the longest time, Mark was not considered to be really of any importance at all. But as the Enlightenment came about, and people were able to use scientific tools to look at the scriptures, and they no longer were in the purview or control of these clerics, these churchmen, okay? And now everybody could have access to this because the printing press and everything else. People started applying certain types of scientific tools to the study of Scripture and everything else. And they started identifying things, and they could actually put things side by side and everything else. And so they came along in the 19th century, a group of German Lutherans who were in the forefront of biblical scholarship, and they took a look at this and they said, we got a problem here. Why are these Gospels so much alike, even to sometimes using the same words in Greek, when Jesus didn't speak in Greek? He spoke in Aramaic. Means they had all kinds of choices to translate that Aramaic word into Greek. It would be like 35 years from now, Don and Linda and Peggy decide to write in Spanish what happens these 4 weeks in this class. And somehow or another, they essentially say the same things, sometimes use the same words in Spanish, and they're all writing independently of one another. What's the odds of that? Slim and none. So how could this be? And so they started out, they started to come up with different hypotheses how this could happen. And they came up with a hypothesis. They said, Mark's not the stepchild in this process. Mark's the primary one. Now you all remember that from our study of Mark a year ago, right?
Yeah.
What happens if we think that Mark was the first gospel written and that Matthew and Luke have a copy of Mark when they write theirs? Suddenly, they developed a formula. They could say, and since we're studying Luke in this class, Luke equals Mark plus some things. And then they looked at them and they said, you know, there are times when Matthew and Luke are the same, but they're not in Mark. And most of the time, it's sayings of Jesus. Maybe the John the Baptist story too. Suppose they had some written words of Jesus that somebody wrote down. And they had this listing of sayings of Jesus. Okay? And these Germans called it Q. For the German word quote. Q-U-E-L-L-E. Source. It means a source. They had some source document of sayings that they shared. Okay. But then they said, wait a while. There are things in Luke that are not in Matthew or Mark. So my apologies to Walter Brennan, but they call that Little Luke. Okay. They belonged to some tradition that Luke had that nobody else had. And so they came up with this hypothesis. Mark is primary. There's some document that Matthew and Luke had, they called Q, that had sayings, maybe the John the Baptist story, maybe something else, like the story about the official coming to ask Jesus to cure his son or slave or something like that. And so they think that they can create this document from scientific study. And you can go to Barnes & Noble and find a book, the Q Gospel. Well, it's not a gospel. It's not there's his best guesstimate of what may have been in Q, but we don't know. Nobody's ever found it. It's a hypothetical document. But it makes this all sense. Because you can do the same thing with Matthew. You can say that Matthew equals Mark plus Q plus little Matthew. Like his infancy narratives and things like that. Things that are peculiar to him in Israel. So that kind of gives you the background. Just to let you know, Matthew uses 500 of Mark's 649 verses. A scholar can go and find Mark in Matthew, and they can find how he used 500 of Mark's 649 verses, which if you do your mathematics is 77% of Mark can be found in Matthew. Okay. How about Luke? Because Luke is what we're studying. Well, Luke uses 350 of Mark's 649 verses. And if you do the mathematics, and I was correct, that's 46%. Okay? You see where they're coming from. Okay. Now, what's interesting is, whatever of Mark that's not in Matthew is in Luke, and whatever of Mark that's not in Luke is in Matthew, except for 8 verses. Okay. So you can see that that's why they felt so strongly about this hypothetical equation of what are the sources for each of these Gospels. Now, this tells us nothing about the source of Mark, for sure. From a scholarly point of view. We believe, as we talked about in the class last year about Mark, is that Peter, there were stories going around and all this other kinds of stuff that Mark got his ideas from. Wrote the gospel, became the primary gospel, Luke and Matthew used it. And then there's that good old boy, John, who's got essentially his own tradition out there and has his own stories and his own way of telling the story of Jesus, which is a little bit different. We'll do John one day too. Just as a little taste, if you were to ask somebody, what is the theme of Matthew, Mark, and Luke? You'd say, well, what Jesus says at the beginning of the gospel, repent, believe in the gospel, the kingdom of God is at hand, right? That's his theme, his preaching principle, and everything plays off of that, okay? And John, what's the theme of the gospel? Jesus, I am, I am. I am, I am, I am. Okay, and always like, because I was a linguist at one time, and not anymore. But I used to study English in an undergraduate school. There was a fellow named Marshall McLuhan, who was a Canadian. Okay, you remember Henry Gibson used to show up and laugh in a little flower and say, Marshall McLuhan, what are you doing? So Marshall McLuhan, said, the medium is the message. Okay. The message in the Synoptic Gospel essentially is the king, repent, reform your lives, the kingdom of God is at hand. And John is Jesus himself. The medium is the message in John. So it's a Marshall McLuhan idea, a kind of a thing. And you see that in all the I am statements and the fact that Jesus talks in these long discourses in John. Right? He speaks in pithy things or parables in the Synoptic Gospels. So you know, he talks differently. He says things differently. And in Matthew, he's going to say, you are the light of the world. Oops. Okay? And then in John's gospel, what he's going to say, I am the light of the world. Okay. And that's why the early patristic fathers used to refer to John as the spiritual gospel. It's different. It's a different tradition. So we're going to take a look. We took a look at Mark last year. We're going to take a look now at Luke and talk a little bit about, and we'll try or do our best to actually read our way through Luke. This is where Bishop Sheen had a little angel that came around. I was just so terrified. So, when you're a teacher and you've got a whole bunch of material and you don't know how to start something out, you present your material in terms of the six W's, don't you? Very often. Who, what, why, when, where, the six W's. So we're going to try to do that with regard to this thing we call the Gospel according to Luke. So let's start with who's Luke. Okay. If you look at the Acts of the Apostles, or you look at some of the Pauline letters, there's a Luke mentioned there. Very educated man, probably a physician, probably came from Syria, okay. Probably was not a Jew, maybe a Gentile, maybe what they would often call a God-fearer. In other words, a Gentile who respected the Jewish religion. Because the Jewish religion had a lot to offer to the pagan world, even if you were not a Jew. They had scripture, the law and the prophets in Jesus' time, right? And some of the wisdom literature. They had very high ethical code, morality, things like that. And so very often there were Gentiles who would be very much attracted to the Jewish faith, but would not want to become an actual Jew. And if you were a man, you understood why. Because there was such a thing as circumcision. You know, and like, oh, well, I really like this stuff, but maybe you don't like it that much. That kind of thing. So Luke might have been a God-fearer. He may have been an actual convert that came into Judaism, but he wasn't a born Jew. Okay? Greek is his native language. Okay? Probably comes from Syria. A couple places you can look to find out more about who this Luke might be would be the letter to the Colossians, chapter 4, verse 14. Philippians, chapter 1, verse 24. 2 Timothy, 4:11. Okay. Well educated. One of the things, reason why, from the evidence of the gospel itself, we don't think that Luke was a native Jew, was because he leaves out a lot of the Jewish controversies that appear in Mark's gospel. Remember, in Mark's gospel, there's always, Jesus always getting in trouble because he and his disciples don't wash their hands before they eat and don't do certain other things. Well, for the most part, Luke, that's the parts that Luke kind of leaves out. Okay? So, number one, his audience was not interested in that. He knew that. And number two, probably he wasn't that interested either. And even though we're going to find out that he was a historian, and it's very important that he puts Jesus' story into the context of the Roman Empire, that kind of a thing, you know, he gets some things mixed up. And he gets some things about Jewish customs mixed up that we're going to run into when we read the gospel. For example, he's going to say that Mary and Joseph come to the temple with Jesus because for their purification. Who's the they? Jesus wasn't impure. He was just born. The husband wasn't impure. So who is they? Somehow or another, he thinks that somehow Mary and Joseph are impure, but Joseph can't be. Mary and Jesus, but Jesus can't be. So he gets the custom kind of confused. Okay? And he does that every once in a while. And he also doesn't understand totally Palestinian geography. just like Mark did. Remember when we talked about Mark? Mark had Jesus going all over the place. That you never would go in that way. You know, and he has people running over hills into water, like, that were miles away from where the place was. He, you know, he doesn't know the geography very well, that kind of thing. So you got that. So who was Luke? Probably the beloved physician, probably a companion of Paul, who went with Paul in some of the journeys, met up with Paul in Troas, went with Paul to mainland Greece, to Philippi, and things like that. There's a part of the Acts of the Apostles, which is not written in third person, but it's written in first person. It goes from Paul went someplace to we went someplace. Okay? And this person we believe that we call Luke also wrote the Acts of the Apostles. So when he does this first person plural telling of the story, it's thought to be autobiographical. He's the we. We went there, kind of the thing. And so that's a little bit about who Luke was. How about what? Well, he's writing the gospel, he's writing the story of Jesus. He's not going to necessarily call it that. He's going to call it an account. Okay. But anyway, it falls in within the four gospels, the written stories of Jesus. He's interested a lot in day-to-day living in his gospel. He's going to talk about day-to-day living. There's going to be less of an emphasis on the end times. Eschatology is called, the end times. Because he already knows that, you know, we're in this for the long haul now. Jesus didn't come back immediately, okay? And so now we need to figure out how we're going to live in this Roman world as Christians. And how are the Romans going to treat us? That we're no threat to the Roman Empire. Even though the person the religion is based on was crucified as a criminal by the Roman Empire. Okay, and we're going to see how he tells Jesus' story like that. It's the longest book in the of the four Gospels. Okay, and then when you add it to Acts of the Apostles as a two-volume set, okay, it's quite long then. Okay, we also know that in the writing, in the copying of these manuscripts, remember they're called manuscript for a reason. Just as an aside, there are a lot of variants in the different manuscripts. In other words, the manuscripts are not exactly alike in terms of their copies. And so that gets us into this whole idea of textual criticism. I don't want to go into it now. But there are a lot of variants in it. And one theory is that part of his gospel lined up in John by an accident, or maybe by purpose. But if there's this part, and we'll see this when we do John, that when you read the story, you say, that doesn't fit in with the rest of the gospel, the tone and temperament. Well, sure sounds like Luke, though, is a woman caught in adultery. Okay. Sounds very much like a Lucan story, because we're going to find out that Luke cares very much about women. Women are prominent in this gospel, much more than Mark or Matthew, that kind of thing. Okay. That's kind of the what. Why? We're going to find out when we start to read the gospel. He's writing to a person, it seems like. This person called Theophilus. Okay. The Theophilus means lover of God or loved by God. Okay? A God lover. Now there could be a real person who had that name. Okay? Or it could be that he's writing to every God lover. You're a God lover, you're a God lover. Anybody's reading this gospel is a God lover. And he's writing this gospel so that what you've been told, you can have real trust in. And we'll see that when we read the gospel. So he's writing to a community that already has knowledge of Jesus. It's not like somebody picked up Luke's gospel for the first time or heard somebody read it and they had never heard of him. They've been told things about Jesus. Okay? The evangelizers, the people wandering around the countryside, the preachers have been there. And so he's writing this account that he's going to do, he says, in a very orderly way, so that you'll trust what you've been told. And you can count on it because I've done my homework real good. So that's why. When? Probably sometime between 80 and 90 AD. When? Why is that? Well, it seems that from the wording of some of the parts of the gospel, it's pretty clear that Jerusalem has fallen during the first Jewish revolt in 70 AD. So it's after 70. And the fact that he puts such an emphasis on day-to-day activities, and not on, remember, Paul said, Paul, we got to get ready. Jesus is coming back tomorrow. The end is near. Okay. That, you don't get that feeling when you read Luke. You get the idea that we're going to be here for a while. Learn how to live in the world. It's a day-to-day existence. Okay. So that's that. Where was it written? Probably in one of two places. Either in Syria, where he came from, or in Greece. Because it's written very much for a Greco-Roman audience. If you knew Greek, people that understand Greek will say that the language that Luke uses, except for the first two chapters, is very good literate Greek. And when you take the story of Jesus, the Gospel, with the story of the Holy Spirit, the Acts of the Apostles, and put it together, people would have read that because of the Greek, the way the language sounded. It would have been like a romance novel. It would have been like picking up a Taylor, this dates me now, Taylor Caldwell novel, who actually wrote about the beloved physician. I used that homily. You know, that kind of a thing. You would have wanted to read this, even if you didn't have any real stake in who Jesus was. Because the Greek is so good. As opposed to, remember, Mark, who had this terrible, he was not that great literate person. But Luke was, okay? And anyway, so that's when, probably for this Greek-speaking people, Syria, Greece, okay? And so who, what, why, when, where, and how, we'll spend a lot of time talking about. But just to give you some of these things, there's going to be language issues, the historical perspective issues. There's a vocabulary in Luke Acts where there are 800 words in Greek that only appear in Luke Acts. Don't appear anywhere else in the New Testament. Okay? So he's got his own vocabulary. When you read it, you love it, don't you? The infancy narratives, the angels and the shepherds and all that kinds of stuff. Glory to God in the highest. He makes use of prayer a lot. Hymns all over the place. People just almost like break into song in the first couple chapters, particularly. You know, Zechariah, Elizabeth, Mary. You know, they're doing all these songs. It's almost like going to Andrew Lloyd Webber thing, and all of a sudden somebody just starts singing, kind of thing. So you're going to get that within Luke's gospel as a kind of a thing. Okay. Let's see what else can I say. I mean, just think of how poor Christianity would be if we didn't have Luke. How much would we know about Mary? Mary's prominent in this gospel. Okay. How much would we know about Pentecost? The Ascension. Okay. Angels intervening in people's lives and things like that. Okay, so there's something about this gospel. He's a wonderful storyteller. He uses great language, and he would have really brought in the Greek reading public into this thing. He would have been, just in terms of selling it, he would have been a well-read author just by virtue of what he does. Okay, so that's kind of like a background. So let me just stop right there and ask it if you have any questions up until now. Who, what, why, when, where, how? Because what we want to do is we want to go ahead and actually start reading this gospel. And then kind of work our way through as best we can. Okay. Now, just if you want to put in your notes, the part of Mark that Luke omits is Mark chapter 6, verse 45 to Mark chapter 8, verse 20. 6:45 to 8:20. And also 9:41 to 10:12. He just skips those. But like I say, most of that is in Matthew. Yeah?
You had a question for Theophilus.
Theophilus. Phil, lover. Theos, God. Theophilus, a God lover.
Could you repeat those references of Colossians, Philippians, and Timothy, which you did?
Colossians 4:14?
Yeah. And you did
Philippians 1:24, 2 Timothy 4:11. Okay. Now, what I would urge you to do as you're reading this is take a piece of paper and just call the heading of it themes, and start writing themes down that you catch as we read through the gospel. And you know, you'll find that there's all kinds of themes going on here within Luke. It's very, very good. In terms of the prayers and hymns I talked about within Luke, you have the Ave Maria that we started the class prayer off with, which is Luke chapter 1, verses 42 to 45. The Magnificat, chapter 1, verses 46 to 55. The Benedictus, chapter 1, verses 67 to 79. The Gloria in Excelsis Deo, chapter 2, verse 14. And the Nunc Dimittis. Now you can dismiss your servant, Lord, Simeon. Chapter 2, verses 29 to 32. Any other questions? So all this is meant to put us into the world of the actual writing of the gospel, okay? You still ready? You ready now? You want to go forward? Let's read this thing? Okay. So get your gospel out. And let's see. Let's begin. Who would like to begin with chapter 1, verse 1? Okay, sister, go. That's Sister Janine, by the way.
Many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the events which have been fulfilled in our midst, precisely as those events were transmitted to us by the original eyewitnesses and ministers of the word. I, too, have carefully traced the whole sequence of events from the beginning and have decided to set it in writing for you, Theophilus, so that Your Excellency may see how reliable the instruction was that you received.
Okay, we'll stop right there. Obviously, she doesn't have the NAB. The New American Bible, the latest version. That's a very old version. I'm going to have to give you a newer version. Remind me, I'll get you a newer version. Okay. But it's okay, but essentially says the same thing. You know, he says, I'm writing to you. It's an actual literary prologue. We don't have a literary prologue in the other Gospels. We don't have it in Mark. Mark says, this is the Gospel of Jesus Christ, as said in the prophet, you know, behold, I sent my messenger before you, that kind of stuff. Matthew says, this is the beginning of the genealogy of Jesus, the Son of Me. John has a prologue, which is a hymn, of course. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and things like that. And then it gets interjected with narrative about John the Baptist in the hymn, that kind of thing. But Luke actually writes a narrative. And we can't tell from the English translation, but this is some of the good Greek. So when somebody first took up this manuscript and started reading, just what we heard Sister Janine say, they'd say, hey, this guy writes real well. It's really good Greek. Okay? And he's saying that he's gone ahead and he's trying to compile different sources together. Where's my table? Remember, Luke equals Mark plus Q plus little Luke. Okay? And he's going to put it in a coherent way. It doesn't mean he's telling you everything in the way it actually happened. As if all he's doing is putting in words what you would have recorded had you had one of those things there in the first century. Okay? But he's doing it in a coherent way so that you, the audience, Theophilus, you God lover, you, can follow what I'm trying to tell you so that you know what you've been taught about Jesus is trustworthy. Okay? So now he's going to go ahead and tell us about the story, okay? So, let's see. Somebody else pick it up from there. Oh, Don, excuse me, question first.
No, I just wondered how far to go.
Well, go ahead, I'll just stop you whenever I want to stop you, because I want to make a point.
The infancy narrative.
Okay.
Announcement of the birth of John. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the priestly division of Abijah. His wife was from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both were righteous in the eyes of God, observing all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blamelessly. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. Once, when he was serving as a priest in his division's turn before God, according to the practice of the priestly service, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord to burn incense. Then, when the whole assembly of the people was praying outside at the hour of the incense offering, the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right of the altar of incense. Zechariah was troubled by what he saw, and fear came upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall name him John, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb, and he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of fathers toward children, and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous, to prepare a people fit for the Lord." Then Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." And the angel said to him in reply, "I am Gabriel, who stand before God. I was sent to speak to you and to announce to you this good news. But now you will be speechless and unable to talk until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting.
John, let's stop. Let's stop it. That's good. Okay. Let's back up. If you were reading this in Greek, suddenly you would have known there was a shift in the language. Okay. Luke is not writing anymore in that elegant style of Greek of his time. He's writing like the Greek version of the Old Testament, which, as you all know from the previous courses I taught you, was called the...
Not the Aramaic.
Septuagint.
Oh.
That's right.
Remember? You see, Septuagint, they usually don't even write it out. They just go LXX for the so-called 70 translators, so actually 72. LXXII, it's kind of messy. So LXX, a nice round number. Think that maybe Monk had something to do with this. It had to be a nice round number, 70. It's the Septuagint. Septuagint was written in a couple hundred years or so before, was written in a style of Greek that was more, say, archaic. Okay? It would be like trying to read something, taking up a newspaper from maybe the Revolutionary War period, and then a paper from today. The language would be noticeably different. Okay? So why is Luke doing that? Because once he gets out of this particular area of the gospel, he's going to go back to nice flowing Greek again. Okay? So why is that? Well, to Luke, and Luke wants to put everything in terms of salvation history in a larger kind of frame of reference. Okay? He wants to put what happens to Jesus and to the church into the history of the world. Okay? He sees the history of the world in kind of like three stages. Okay? There's the chosen people, right? Israel. Okay? That's the Old Testament period. Okay? Then there's Jesus, the gospel, And then there's the church and the Holy Spirit. And that's the Acts of the Apostles. Okay. So it's the era of epic of the Old Testament epic. Gospel time, Jesus' time, and the church time, the Acts of the Apostles. And so what he's doing is he's creating bridges between the Old Testament and Jesus coming. And so he wants to present these figures in the first couple chapters, like Zechariah and Elizabeth and all these people, like people were in the Old Testament. They're going to remind you of people in the Old Testament. Mary's going to do the Magnificat, which is going to remind you of Hannah's song from the first book of Samuel from the Old Testament. So he's presenting all these figures in these first couple chapters like they're prototypes in the Hebrew scriptures, but not from the Hebrew version of it, but from the Greek version of it, which was, remember, the version of the Old Testament we call the Old Testament today. They would have called the sacred scripture that the early church used. They didn't necessarily use the Hebrew, they used the Greek translation of the Hebrew as their sacred scripture. So he's going to create this bridge with people like Elizabeth and Zechariah and everything, and here, John the Baptist, to get you to Jesus. And Jesus' ascension, as you know from going on Ascension Thursday, is told twice by Luke. It's told in the Gospel, but it's also told in the Acts of the Apostles. So he picks this up. So that's the bridge into the third part of the epic. Okay? So that's it.
Did Mark do that too?
No. Mark does not have any infancy narratives. Mark begins right with John the Baptist's story. You know, as it's written in the prophet, "Lo, I send my messenger before you to prepare your way, a voice of one crying in the desert, make straight the way of the Lord, make straight his path," and so on and so forth. Only Matthew and Luke have these infancy narratives. Mark either doesn't know about it or it's not important to him, okay, to tell these stories. But for Matthew and Luke, it was important to talk about Jesus before he shows up at the River Jordan with John the Baptist.
Set the stage.
To set the stage for it. And so from his perspective, he's telling those first couple chapters of his gospel using the vocabulary and the language and the style of writing that would have been familiar to the people who read the Septuagint. Then once he gets into that, and Jesus is like a full-grown man now, he's going to go back into this very florid, beautiful Greek style of writing. Okay? Because he wants to, again, the medium is the message, he wants to use a certain type of language to put you back into, remind you of the Old Testament period, that these people serve as functionaries to get you in the bridge from the Old Testament to Jesus. Okay. Like, for example, Elizabeth, it's Elisheba. You know, everybody's seen the movie The Ten Commandments. Remember, there's Elisheba in The Ten Commandments. Fill all the baskets with water, right? That's Aaron's wife, okay? So we have an Elizabeth in this story, and that kind of thing. So you got that kind of thing going on, okay? And you got to remember too that that there are a couple different ways of telling time, okay? From two Greek words, kairos and chronos. Luke's going to use principally kairos. He's going to say, when Quirinius was governor of Syria, when so-and-so, and all these events, when certain people lived, that's how he's going to say, and then this thing happened. Okay. Chronos has to do with counting like numbers, like 12, 15, 2013. Although, you're going to say, yeah, but it's based upon an event, the birth of Jesus. That's 2013 AD as opposed to whatever. Okay. Yeah. But usually we think chronology versus chirology. It would be like trying to say to you years from now, Father Russ had this class in Luke during the presidency of Barack Obama. That's chirology. some important event. Okay, and that puts it into a context. When exactly during the presidency of Barack Obama, I can tell you, but you, so now you think, well, okay, when was Barack Obama president? Who's president between this? So this means that this happened between this date and this date. So he tells time by taking it in terms of the event that happens, as opposed to a number kind of event, okay? That kind of thing. Remember that in the gospel stories too, there are two Herods, aren't there? There's Herod the Great, who was an Idumean, a half-breed, who wasn't even Jewish, who was the king of the Jews. Okay? And then there was Herod Antipas, one of his sons, who was the tetrarch or ruler in Galilee. Okay? Herod the Great, we know most of from Matthew's gospel, don't we, for the slaughter of the innocents. Okay? He doesn't like that there was a king born in his empire. Okay? Let's get rid of him. Okay? He essentially got rid of about all of his relatives before he died. He killed his favorite wife. He killed a bunch of sons. The fact that there were four sons left when Herod the Great died was probably a small miracle in and of itself. Yeah, they killed them all the rest of them. Okay. And one of them is Herod Antipas, who winds up being the Tetrarch of Galilee. One of his name is Philip, who's a Tetrarch. We're going to find him in Turia and some other name of the place. It's a tongue twister. Okay. And then there was a third son whose name was Archelaus. And Archelaus was given about half of the kingdom, which included what we call Judea. He was a chip off the old block. He was like his father. And the Jews went to Rome and said, "We can't stand this guy. You got to get rid of him." Okay. And about 6 AD, they said, "Fine. Archelaus, you're out. And you're now going to have a Roman prefect in charge of Judea," which is the reason why in Jesus' time there's Pontius Pilate in Judea. The fourth son was also called Philip. He was a private citizen in Rome. And he's the one who was the husband of Herodias. When Herod Antipas went back to Rome to curry favor with the emperor, he stole his brother's wife and brought her back to Palestine, and that got him in all kinds of trouble with John the Baptist, and wound up getting John the Baptist beheaded. So there's two different Herods. Herod the Great ruled between 37 and 4 BC. We know when he ruled. So that's a little bit of the background there. Zechariah, as we heard, was a priest. Now, it wasn't, remember, like it was in modern times where somebody, discerns the priesthood. You were a priest because you were born into a family. There was a family of priests. So by birth, Zechariah was a priest. And he wasn't stationed in Jerusalem at the temple all the time. So he would come to the temple when it was his turn to go and serve in the temple for 2 weeks. It was like TAD and then AD. You would go to the temple in Jerusalem and you would serve as that. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Okay. And you were chosen by lot to do certain things. So there may have been all kinds of people there on TAD. And everybody couldn't do what needed to be done. So they would choose by lot who was to do something that day, like offer incense. In the temple in Jerusalem, there were like three areas. There was the Holy of Holies, which only the high priest could go into once a year on the Day of Atonement. And remember, they put the little rope around him so in case he had a heart attack and he said the word of God out loud, and they couldn't go in to get him, they could pull him out if he didn't come out in time. Okay? Then there was, before that, like an altar of incense, and that's where Zechariah goes in. And he goes in probably what we would call 3 o'clock in the afternoon to offer prayer and incense on that altar, okay? And then the third room or section was like a vestibule leading to the holy place. And twice a day, morning and afternoon, a priest chosen by lot entered the holy place to burn incense on the altar. A later Jewish writing indicates that a priest was generally allowed to do so only once in a lifetime. So that's what Zechariah is doing. So he's got his once in a lifetime chance because he's a priest that lives out away from Jerusalem. okay? And he's now back on TAD, and he's got a chance to go into the temple to do this burning of incense, and he meets somebody. So we've gone for about an hour. Where's my timekeeper?
I'm just going to go okay. Like this.
So let's take a 5-minute break, okay? To the internet and says, what are the 10 most popular names to name for a child? Something like, where did he get that from? Kind of thing. But they were meant to tell you about the person, okay? And we hear that Zechariah, okay? And let's see if I can find it. I've got his name in here someplace. I'll tell you what that is in a second. But he meets an angel, doesn't he? In this particular case, what we know is an archangel by the name of Gabriel, okay? Who's God's messenger, right? Now, what you've got to understand is, and you won't know the exact meaning of the name either without looking it up, but whenever you see a name coming from the Hebrew or Aramaic, and it ends in E-L, means God, because El was the Sumerian name, generic name for God. When God appeared to Abram, he appeared as El Shaddai, God the Almighty, God of the mountain tops, kind of a thing, okay? And so Gabriel means God is my strength. Michael means who is like God, okay? Remember, Gabriel is the great messenger. Michael is the great fighter of the hosts. Remember, you see the word host, it doesn't mean those hosts like it usually, it means an army. That's what a host meant. When we say, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts, we mean armies, okay? Armies of angels, okay? So who's like God? And Raphael, you know, from the story of Tobit and stuff like that, is God who heals, God's remedy, okay? Remember, Raphael heals the blindness, the scales on the eyes, you know, that kind of stuff, right? From the story of Tobias and things. Okay, so anyway, so he meets this angel, okay? And the angel, of course, tells him some things, okay? And of course, Zechariah means, God has remembered us. Elizabeth, means God is fullness. Remember, she's going to be barren, and now she's going to be full. In care of John the Baptist, okay? John means God is gracious. Miriam means beloved. Okay. Jesus, you know, Joshua, means God saves. Yahweh saves. Okay. And Joseph means God gathers together. Good name for him, right? That's what he does. He gathers the Holy Family together. That's what he does. Okay? So anyway, Zechariah means God has remembered us. Elizabeth means God is fullness. John, as in John the Baptist, means God is gracious. Miriam, Mary, means beloved. Jesus, Joshua, okay, means Yahweh saves, God saves, salvation, Savior, okay. Joseph means God gathers together. And you think back to the Joseph of the Old Testament, he gathers his family together, doesn't he? In Egypt. Okay. And so names mean a lot. So Zechariah, God has remembered us, okay. Because you've got to remember, when you had no children, this was like the end of the world to these ancient people. Okay? That meant somehow or another, God did not favor you. Because a woman was meant to be fertile and have a bunch of kids. Because most of the kids, and we'll talk about numbers as we go along, never made it to their teens. Most of them died, if they didn't die after in infancy, you know, about 35%, I think, is the number, were dead by the age of 12. So when we find out in these gospel stories that there was somebody who was 12 years old that had died, that's not an unusual occurrence in this culture. Okay? They don't have a good diet, drinking water is suspect, They don't get flu shots and other kinds of things like we do. And so life expectancy for a peasant was about 35 years old in Jesus' time. Now, if you were rich and could afford to live like and you were one of the haves, you might live to 50 or so. Okay? These people have lived to be 70, 80, 90. That was extraordinary. Now today, we just, not too long ago, Chris knows, we lost a 104-year-old parishioner. You know, when Mary Wade died. We know, you know, that was extraordinary. I mean, extraordinary now. It was really extraordinary then. So when you get all these ages in the Bible, what they're really telling you is not that that person really was necessarily that age, but they were saying they were really highly favored by God. They had a long life. That kind of thing, okay? So in our story that Don read so well for us, this angel Gabriel shows up. And it's not unusual when an angel shows up to be what? Frightened out of your wits. Why me? Yeah, you know, and you're scared. And usually the first thing the angels do is say, don't be afraid. I'm from God. Don't be afraid. No. Okay? Gabriel has a tendency to turn people dumb. They can't speak. He does it in the book of Daniel. The Daniel at one point. Okay? That kind of thing. So he's the messenger of the archangels. He's sent down on really, really important glad tidings type thing. So he comes down. He meets Zechariah. And he says to Zechariah, you know, you guys are going to have a son. And he's going to be ready. Okay? He's going to be like Elijah, that great prophet from 1 Kings chapter 17 to 2 Kings chapter 2, where his story is. Okay? He wore certain types of clothing. And John the Baptist is going to wear the same type of clothing. Okay? And it was a general thought that, okay, that this, and Elijah would come back, because remember, he supposedly didn't die. He went up to heaven in a fiery chariot. Okay? That, and of course, then the History Channel says he went up in some kind of alien spacecraft. Okay. But anyway, but he's going to come back. He's going to come back before the day of the Lord. That's an interesting, the day of the Lord, or that day. And it was meant to be different things at different times, but it essentially was a time in which God would intervene once and for all. And if the Messiah was God's anointed, this Elijah figure would show up before the Messiah would come, and everything would be turned right, and justice would take over the world, and Romans would be thrown out, and everybody who was wicked would be destroyed, and goodness would take over, and God would be in charge, kind of a thing. Intervention time. The book of Malachi, chapter 3, verses 23 to 24. Lo, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the day of the Lord comes, the great and terrible day, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. So Luke is presenting John the Baptist in terms of these Old Testament figures like Elijah and that kind of a thing, okay? And of course, Zechariah says, well, how can I know this? No. And of course, he wants a sign. And it's not unusual in the Old Testament to have somebody ask for a sign, isn't it? Remember Gideon always wanted the fleece wet, or no, not with the fleece wet now, I want the ground wet, not the fleece. Remember I played that game with God, you know, and all kinds of stuff. Or Ahaz, you know, Isaiah says to him, ask for a sign. Oh no, I wouldn't dare ask the Lord for a sign. No, not me. And Isaiah says, well, isn't it enough that you worry people and I should worry my God? This will be the sign. The virgin will be with child and bear a son, and you will call him Emmanuel. That kind of, so there's a history of asking for signs, okay? And okay, Gabriel says, I'll leave you a sign, you're gonna be speechless. Until the day comes when you realize that what I've told you is absolutely correct.
Okay? I have always had this. Zechariah is punished because he asks, how will I know this? Mary asks, how can this be? And he gets punished and she doesn't.
Mary must have been highly favored of God.
But it seemed like the two were a very similar situation.
Yeah, it seems that way. The explanation usually is that Mary doesn't believe that it's going to happen. Now, this is reading into it. But she just says, well, yeah, okay, I agree with you, but I'm not married, and I've never been with a man, and I'm going to have a child then. Come. Where Zechariah, it seems more of, well, this can't be. Now that's reading into it.
You've got to be kidding me.
Yeah, you've got to be kidding me. As old as I am, well, who was an old person that had a child in the Old Testament?
Abraham. Yeah.
Sarah. Mm-hmm. See? And he's presenting Zechariah and Elizabeth like Abraham and Sarah. Okay? So he's writing in this archaic sort of Greek that's from a couple centuries earlier to remind you of the Septuagint, the Greek Old Testament. These are Old Testament type figures and everything else. And now, Don, you mind reading? You did so well. Pick up the story. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent.
We're going to pick it up where? What's the verse?
Oh, meanwhile. Okay, yeah, meanwhile the people. Okay, I'm off. Meanwhile.
Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and were amazed that he stayed so long in the sanctuary. But when he came out, he was unable to speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He was gesturing to them, but remained mute. Then, when his days of ministry were completed, he went home.
That was 2 weeks. Okay.
After this time, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and she went into seclusion for 5 months, saying, "So has the Lord done for me at a time when he has seen fit to take away my disgrace before others."
The disgrace would have been not that she was a sinner, but that she had no children and she was elderly. Okay. Keep going.
Announcement of the birth of Jesus. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And coming to her, he said, "Hail, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at what was said and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of David his father, and he will rule over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." But Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I have no relations with a man?" And the angel said to her in reply, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month for her who was called barren, for nothing will be impossible for God." Mary said, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Okay, let's stop there. That's the annunciation. Oh, no. Nazareth. Nazareth was a nondescript little farming village that probably had several hundred inhabitants at the time of Jesus. It's not even mentioned in the Old Testament anywhere. Okay, so it's an insignificant little place. And even though he calls it a town, literally a city, it wasn't a city in any sense of the real word. Now it was near a major city, and we'll talk about that later, that doesn't appear in the New Testament at all either. But when we get a little bit further along, we'll talk about that, okay?
Now, you're saying that it wasn't mentioned in the Old Testament, but in some place...
And Matthew says it would be
called
the Nazarene. It ain't there anywhere.
You can't find it
anywhere. We don't know where that came from. you got to understand, too, that in the period in which these people are writing what we call the New Testament today, there were a lot of what they call intertestamental writings out there that were not part, would not become part of the canon of the Old Testament, nor the canon of the New Testament. But people got a lot of their ideas about like what the Messiah would be like from those intertestamental writings that were out there, okay? You know, and that kind of a thing. So these non-canonical writings had a lot of influence on people. Now, we have the same thing today, you don't really think that. Here we are sitting in St. Anne's Parish to talk about, you know, Anne and Joachim. They don't appear in the New Testament. They appear in a non-canonical work that has a great influence on us, even though it's not part of the New Testament. So don't, you know, so sometimes this Nazarene thing might have been some document that only Matthew knew about, but it's not in the Old Testament.
Gospel according to Thomas.
Well, I don't know about that. That's not good.
Father, is this the apocrypha you're talking about, or is that different?
Oh, I didn't want to get into that. But anyway.
You don't have to.
Well,
just tell me the question.
No, I would call it pseudo-epigraphical. I'm very much don't put that. Okay. The New Testament between the Protestants and the Catholics is the same, even though Luther didn't like the letter of James, but he still translated it into German. The New Testament and our canon, we have about 7 books and parts of some other books that we consider canonical that the Protestants don't consider canonical. They call that apocryphal. Okay.
So the Gospel of Thomas is...
Okay, let me get into it. That's the Old Testament, okay? We call it deuterocanonical, the second canon, because we take our canon from the Septuagint, okay? Allowed more books into the canon than the Hebrew canon did. For certain, those books are not written in Hebrew. It's like 1 and 2 Maccabees. So they're not in the Hebrew canon, but they're in the Septuagint canon, the Greek canon. Okay? Because the people who thought it belonged there thought God could speak in Greek too. He didn't. He wasn't confined by Hebrew. He could speak in Aramaic or Greek. What mattered was the content of the book. And whatnot, it fit certain other criteria. So we're going to say that. So we call that, Catholics call that deuterocanonical, the second canon, those 7 books. Okay. Then there's a bunch of New Testament books that neither one of us claim. We would call those books apocryphal books. The Protestants call them pseudo-epigraphical, written falsely afterwards in the Greek. Okay? Because they already have the apocryphal. If you were to pick up a Protestant Bible, it would probably say, translation of the New and the Old Testament and the Apocrypha. And what they would do is they would put the Old Testament books by the Hebrew canon, and then you would have the 7 Apocrypha books, and then you would have the New Testament. They would say these books are not as worthy of anything as the other books are. You follow me with that? Okay? So that's what the Protestants call apocryphal. We would call these books, like here's one, like Gospel of Thomas, Gospel of Mary Magdalene, and all Peter, and the Cross Gospel, and all the other things that have been found. We would call them apocryphal. Protestants would call them pseudo, falsely, epi, after, graphical, written, falsely written after. No. You didn't want to know that. But anyway, that's it. Yeah, so these are not, canonical means they're in the canon. We said, this is the Word of God. In fact, before I go, I'm going to talk a little bit about the Word of God again, because I got a couple of handouts for you. And I didn't do it when I did my introduction, which is probably just as well. But we're going to talk about they, verbum again. And the people who have been in my classes have heard that before, that phrase they, verbum, and all kinds of stuff.
Father, can I ask, this is a fluff question. Why were the women always barren? It was their fault.
It's always the women's fault. Think of Henry VIII. He never said, hey, it's really my fault. I'm, you know, it's the wrong type of... Mm. And no, they didn't know enough to know that it was the guy had something to do with this, you know. But they did. And anyway, the idea of having a lot of children was you were blessed by God. Because remember, the idea of an afterlife is still a little bit nebulous in Jesus' time. You know, you have this idea of Hades or Sheol in Hebrew, which is this nebulous place that you go to, go down into the pit when you die. How many of the Psalms talk about going down into the pit? Okay. You know, finally, about Jesus' time, we're starting to get into this idea that there really is some sort of an afterlife. You see it in Maccabees. You see it in Daniel. You see it in the Book of Wisdom, which, of course, is part of that Protestant apocrypha, because Wisdom was written in Greek, okay, and that kind of a thing. And so you're starting to get this idea. Remember, Jesus gets into this big debate with the Sadducees who don't believe in an afterlife, because they only take the first five books as being Scripture. And there's no mention of an afterlife in the Torah. So therefore they talk about this thing about this guy got married and he died, and then his other brother took her and he died. And now they're all dead. Now whose wife is she when she gets to heaven? And Jesus says, it don't work that way. So, you know, this idea of an afterlife is something. So you had to be blessed by God in this life. And this is me talking, maybe you shouldn't be able to take. But a lot of the televangelists have a very Old Testament idea about this life. You know, Joel Osteen's going to say, God's going to bless you in this life. You're going to have two cars, and you're going to have, you know, three houses, and you're going to do all this stuff. God has all these wonderful things in mind for you. But just be sending your money to my church. Right? Yeah, you've got to be blessed with things here to show God's favor. That's a very Old Testament idea. We know that a lot of wonderful people that are beloved by God, we talk about redemptive suffering in the Did You Know That class, I think, the last time. You know, sometimes I have a very terrible life. Alan suffered. He wasn't being punished or anything else. He didn't have three cars and two garages and $1 million in the bank. Okay? But God loved him. So we have a little bit different idea. But this Old Testament idea is that you had to get it here because there ain't nothing else for most of the Old Testament writings until you get to Wisdom and part of Daniel and one or two Maccabees. Part of Daniel and Wisdom just happened to be not part of those apocrypha books for the Protestants. Okay? So you can see where their mindset is. It's got to be here, because it ain't the place else it's going to be. We Catholics says there's going to be another place. So I don't know how we got into that. But anyway, your question about being married. It's always the woman's fault. Or at least, typically, most of these things are very on me.
You and I agreed on that this afternoon.
And they had no idea
how anything works.
Modern biology or
no, they know that stuff. And that's when we get, I'll give you some handouts of doing it if you haven't gotten any of our classes. I've only made a few. But we believe that Scripture is inerrant, okay, for those things that are necessary for salvation. Not every word. That's a Catholic viewpoint of Scripture. Okay. So the writers of Genesis were not scientists. Luke may have been a physician, but he's not Dr. Welby. He only knows what medicine is in the first century AD. Okay? So that's the science not in Genesis is what not what's inerrant, you know. It's what's necessary for salvation that's inspired. So Luke can make an error. Quirinius wasn't governor of Syria when Jesus was born, you know, that kind of a thing. But it doesn't matter. Jesus was born. It doesn't matter if he was born in 4 BC or 2 BC or what we call 6 AD, whatever. You know what I'm saying? So what's important is what's necessary for salvation. And that's what's important. Now, talk about this betrothed business, just to let you know. There were two stages. Usually before the ages of 12 and 13, a young woman was betrothed by her father to a young man. And it was a lot of negotiation that went back and forth. Okay. And betrothal was more than just an engagement, though. A betrothal couple was considered married and were spoken of as husband and wife, even though the bride continued to live in her father's house and the couple refrained from sexual relations. Okay. That's what Joseph would have had a problem with. They were betrothed. They were considered to be man and wife, but Mary had not come to live in his house yet. She still was with Anna and Joseph, if they were alive, or whoever was a part of her family. Okay? Okay? And then a year or so later, the betrothed husband would bring his wife to live in his house, and they would begin to have sexual relations. Okay? Okay? And, you know, that's the all the stories about, you know, the bridegroom is coming, light your lamps, and all that kinds of stuff. And that's the background of how that all thing happened. Okay? Okay? Hail was usual Greek greeting, equivalent to the English hello. But it really means something like rejoice. So when the angel says to Mary, hail. Okay, that kind of defense, okay. And Mary's perplexed, and that's a trouble. She's perplexed, like, wait, what's going on here, okay? Okay. And notice, and this is a theme in Luke's gospel a lot, he does parallel construction. He's going to talk about, remember he talked about the birth of John the Baptist with Gabriel going to announce it, and he does Gabriel coming to announce it to Mary. So they're kind of like parallel stories. Okay. If you go back, you can put the two stories together if you want. You can see how Gabriel hailed, you know, and tells what's going on and everything else like that. Okay. Okay. Very often, huh?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
There are two words in Latin, too, for hail. The ave was the hello, and the salve was the more glorious.
But remember, he's writing in Greek, though. I don't mean that. But
Jerome, or whoever did the translation, would have taken a like meaning, or words in Latin that showed that same meaning.
Sure. Okay, and a lot of times in the Old Testament, somebody will show up and tell about the birth of a child and give his name right then. And that's kind of like a heads up, like, this child's not going to be an ordinary child. Because typically what happened is the father would name the child, and it was expected to be named after somebody in the father's family. So you were always using, you know, other names of male people in your family, usually the father. Or something like that, you know, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, Timothy's son, that kind of a thing. Okay. And here, you know, the angel tells her what the child is going to be called. Okay. We talked a little about her response. Okay. Son of God. Okay. Is an expression that actually meant different things in the Old Testament. Okay. The king was thought to be a son of God. Okay, go back to some of the Psalms, like Psalm 2 and things like that. Okay? With a small s, son of God. Okay? In other words, he was favored by some way by God. Angels were often referred to as sons of God. Okay? Very holy people were very often referred to as a son of God. Okay? Because we mean this in a particular way, theologically, with big S, son of God. Okay. But just keep that in mind when you read the Old Testament, you'll have other people referred to as the Son of God.
Is that, and I might be wrong on this, but is it that Jesus referring to himself to the apostles, referring to him as the Son of God? Isn't that one of those things that's particularly common to all four of the Gospels?
Son of God, yeah. And was peculiar. No, it appears once in John, the Son of Man, that he calls himself. Which we'll probably get into later on, but it, you know, comes from Ezekiel and also Daniel. Son of Man would be, on one hand, you're a human being. Eddie, you're a son of man. You're a human being. Oh, and also, in Daniel, it means this sky figure who is God's right hand in terms of judgment. Okay? Son of Man. Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man. And it's pretty much a synoptic convention, but it does appear once in John's Gospel. But whenever I hear it, it strikes my ear string. And now, okay. So that's the idea of Son of God, and what exactly it meant is the reason why the church went through all these councils to describe exactly how Jesus was uniquely the Son of God. Okay, that kind of. Okay. Handmaid is usually translated, really means slave. Okay? You're the slave of God. This is an interesting point, I think. Now, we think we want to get rid of slavery, don't we? Okay? We don't want to be a slave to anybody. Okay? The Hebrews left slavery in Egypt, right? They were slaves to Pharaoh. But the idea always was you were meant to be a slave to God and God only. That's the best thing to do, is to be God's slave. Which means you're totally committed to doing God's will. Okay? And that's an interesting thought, because normally we don't like the word slave. You see the word slave and I'm not a slave to anybody. Okay? But you're meant to be a slave for God.
Can I argue that?
You can argue.
But in the Old Testament, I agree 100%. And yet, through Christ, mm-hmm. we become children of God, which is a conversion from that slavery to being heirs of the kingdom of heaven and to be sharers in the divine life of God.
But Mary says she's the slave of God.
She's still in the Old Testament. Christ hasn't come yet.
Oh, okay. She's playing on
He
side.
Has not.
We can think of it that way. Well, think about it. To be God's slave is not a bad thing. To be God's slave is actually a very, very good thing. That means that
God's
will is your will.
But to be God's child is so much more.
Maybe. Now, this is where we're going to get into arguing with Father Barron. You need to be reading my blogs.
I have.
Okay? Because Barron says our lives are not about us.
I know.
They're all about Christ.
I was going to write you a response.
Barron's coming out with a new series, by the way, on Catholicism.
I can argue.
Evangelization. Oh, you can argue, yeah. But I mean, do you understand what he's talking about? Then? And you understand what I'm talking about? Because when Mary says, I'm the slave, she's replacing the Jewish idea of slavery to Pharaoh to being a slave to God. That's a completely different ballgame.
And even, we're thinking in what Father Barron is saying is our obedience that we owe to God.
And that's what she's saying, that's what I'm saying.
Right. Except for the fact there's a difference, and a vast difference, between a person who is a slave offering obedience to a master and a son or a daughter who offers obedience to their father because of the love they have for him.
Once again, that's a motive. That hasn't changed the situation. Mary was the slave of the Lord. He had done it to me according to your word.
I think it.
But she was also restored in the situation. Else. We're a both-and people. You got to think in terms of both-and. It's not an either-or situation.
You conservatives, you're all.
You mean we Orthodox people? But anyway, it's the same.
But yeah, but like you said, Father, we're both-and. You know, the message of Jesus. He defeats death by dying. Mm-hmm. We defeat our enemy by lovingness, mm-hmm. by turning the other cheek. Mm-hmm. Slave in the context of being a slave, you have no will. Well, no. You're a slave to God.
It's
you're
different.
Your will. Yeah,
it's different than being a slave to Pharaoh. Yeah, it's a completely different thing. The idea of Nazareth, away from where Zechariah lived, was probably about an 85-mile journey. And you remember back from my last homily about the Holy Family. Hope she got in a caravan to go that 85 miles, because that's a lot of ways to go with a lot of brigands and, remember, Good Samaritan and all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of robbers around. And traveling was not an easy thing. It's not like us getting on, you know, I did my map quest. You know, it's a two-day drive from here directly to 40 West to Albuquerque. I get on the interstate and go. No problem. But in this culture, travel was a very, very, very scary thing. So she's traveling a long distance from Nazareth to get to see Elizabeth. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Where do we leave off in the reading?
Chapter 39. Our verse 37.
Okay. Go ahead. You're doing so well, Don.
Oh, you're going to keep me on.
Yeah.
Mary visits Elizabeth. During those days, Mary set out and traveled to the hill country in haste, to a town of Judah, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth.
When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, and the infant in her womb leaped, and Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, cried out in a loud voice and said, "Most blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does this happen to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For at the moment the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the infant in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed are you who believe that what was spoken to you by the Lord would be fulfilled."
Okay, let's just stop there for a second. A great talk back to 85 miles. The way Elizabeth addresses Mary also echoes some Old Testament praise for Israelite heroines. The prophetess Deborah proclaimed Jael to be blessed among women for slaying an enemy general. That's Judges chapter 5, verses 24 to 27. Judith was praised as blessed above all the women on earth for slaying another enemy general, Judith chapter 13, 18. But Mary is blessed, however, not for causing death, but because she's bringing forth life. Okay. And so the people who understood the Septuagint would have had all these echoes in their head from the Old Testament. And Mary's also always blessed because of her child. You know, when you get right down to it, the bottom line is, as the Brits would say, at the end of the day, Mary is who Mary is because of her relationship with Jesus. It's Jesus. Whenever Protestants say, "Well, we worship Mary," no, we don't worship Mary. We venerate Mary. We honor Mary because of her relationship to her Son. And you see this always in the antiphons in the Liturgy of the Hours. Because there'll be some Marian feast, and I'll start out some. Today we worship the Son of God as we honor His mother, or words to that effect. You always get that in those antiphons for Marian feasts. It never puts Mary there. It's Jesus, okay, that you worship, and that kind of. If you want to go back and look at the prototype for Mary's Magnificat, it appears in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 to 10, and that's the prayer of Hannah, of course. When she brings Samuel to stay in the temple. Jesus will go to the temple too, but he won't stay. He'll go back to Nazareth, that kind of a thing. Okay?
Father, in the previous, with the announcement of Gabriel, you spent some time on him telling her that he would be called the Son of God. Mm-hmm. But wouldn't it have been more important to the writer that he be called holy, because only God was considered holy in that context?
Well, now you get into a both-and thing again. I mean, the Holy One of Israel is God. So Jesus will say at some point in one of the Gospels, "No one."
Why do you call me holy?
Why do you call me God? Is holy. But there were people throughout the Old Testament that were referred to as being holy or blessed. And I gave you a couple examples of that. So it can be holy with a small H or holy with a capital H. Okay. God is the one who's holy with capital H. To be holy meant to be kind of separated, different than other people. Yeah, you can look at it that way. Of course, His mercy is from age to age. Of course, that's a wonderful Hebrew word, hesed, isn't it? H-E-S-E-D in English. Which is mercy, love, steadfast love, compassion, all these other kinds of things. It's all thrown up into one. That's the main kind of characteristic that you get about God from the Old Testament. That's that hesed, okay, His faithfulness, His steadfast love, and things like that. Okay. Let's see. Okay. Let's go on then. We're all very familiar with the Magnificat, I think. Okay, go ahead. The birth and naming of John. Go ahead.
When the time arrived for Elizabeth to have her child, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown His great mercy toward her, and they rejoiced with her. When they came on the eighth day to circumcise the child, they were going to call him Zechariah after his father. But his mother said in reply, "No, he will be called John." But they answered her, "Excuse me. There is no one among your relatives." Somebody better take over.
Okay.
"There is no one among your relatives who has this name." Mm-hmm. "So they made signs asking his father what he wished to be called. He asked for a tablet and wrote, John is his name, and all were amazed. Immediately his mouth opened, his tongue freed, and he spoke blessing God. Then fear came upon all their neighbors, and all the matters were discussed throughout the hill country of Judea. All who heard these things took them to heart, saying, "What then will this child be? For surely the hand of the Lord was with him."
Okay, stop there. It was, like I said, it was usually customary, but the child was not named after the father. It was certainly named after one of the relatives. So it was a name that was part of the family, like heritage or tradition. And John apparently was a completely new name, because we talk God is gracious and things like that. It always reminds me, apparently my name was going to be Timothy Bruce, of all things. And I have a half-sister who's 18 years older than me. And I'm the only child of my father and mother. And when the nun in the hospital heard that I was going to be called Timothy Bruce, she said, "No. I've waited all these years for this child. The father's name is Russell, so his first name is going to be Russell. Now, what's his middle name going to be?" And that's how I became Russell David. Because my father's name was Russell. Fortunately, he didn't give me the Ivan, so I wasn't stuck with Ivan. But anyway, that was the tradition. So this is another way of saying, hey, this child's different. This is going to be a different, this is not your ordinary birth. This isn't your ordinary child here, okay? So he's going to do significant things, okay? He's going to be different, okay? Let's see what else we want to say about that. Let's go on then. Zechariah is going to break into song too. Eddie, you want to read that, or Jeff?
The Canticle of Zechariah. Then Zechariah, his father, filled with the Holy Spirit, prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, for he has visited and brought redemption to his people. He has raised up a horn for our salvation within the house of David, his servant, even as he promised through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers, and to be mindful of his holy covenant, and of the oath he swore to Abraham, our father, and to grant us that, rescued from the hands of enemies, without fear, we might worship him in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give his people knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the daybreak from on high will visit us, to shine on those who sit in darkness and death's shadow, to guide our feet into the path of peace." The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the desert until the day of his manifestation to Israel.
Okay, I didn't stop there. Notice that the child grew and became strong. Remember what Luke's going to do, the same sort of a verse about Jesus, but a little bit more involved in it. He starts out and he says, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel." And these opening words of Zechariah's prayer are already used in the book of Psalms to mark the end of three collections of Psalms. You want to look it up, Psalm 41, verse 14. 41, 14. Psalm 72, verse 18. 72, 18. And Psalm 106, verse 48. Again, Luke is putting all this back into the context of the Old Testament, okay? Horn, okay, is a symbol of strength, isn't it? Like a horn of a bull and all that kinds of stuff, okay? So it was a biblical idiom for strength all the time, okay? Okay. He talks about knowledge, of course, means experience. God will help his people by experience. John will help the people by experiencing God's forgiveness and things like that. Mercy of God is his profound, heartfelt compassion for us, forgiving our sins and granting salvation.
Okay. Are you sure about that horn?
Yeah.
I didn't think of it in terms of strength, but he is a trumpeter, one who is going to blast out the good news that
God is around.
That's okay. I mean, if you would think that. But I mean, typically in the Old Testament, horn, it's going to show up in Hannah's song too.
Oh, okay.
It's a sign of power. Because remember, even in the Exodus story, when people, Moses, went to the mountain, and they wanted to make a God, they came up with a bull with the horns, and the horn being up, it's a sign of strength. If you want to do that, I mean, obviously, there are multiple, as long as it doesn't violate, you know, some tenet of the faith, you can come up with other arguments, various. And this is what people did all the time in their old church. They always coming up with allegorical explanations for everything, right? This was symbolic of something. And so you have a church father coming up with all kinds of stuff.
Does it mean strength in Revelations too?
Well, it depends on what the context it's used in. It might mean devastation, but most time, yeah, it means strength. Because the book of Revelation, remember, is really, and we're going to do this in the summer, you need to read all the footnotes when you get your book of Revelation out, because a lot of the stuff is using language from the Old Testament. Okay, and horn typically as a sign of strength. Okay. Okay. Uh-huh. Liturgy of the Hours? We're back. It's different. This goes back to the comment I make in every class, so I'll make it again. Every translation is an interpretation. You've got a word from another language and from another time that now you have to put into the language of your time. So you're making choices. Okay? And by just making choices, you're making perhaps a meaning to the word that maybe, I'll hold me to that, was not the original meaning of the word when it was originally used. Some translations are better than other translations. Some are closer to the English than other translations. You've lived with that through this last year, and I've lived with that. You don't know how tough it is to read those columns now at Mass with the language change. I mean, I find, the old ones were very simple and straightforward and everything else. And now we pray, oh Lord, good. Where does the comma go? Where do I put a stop at? What part of the word goes with what other part of the word? And suddenly you go and take the old translation, take a look at the new translation, and you say, oh, I didn't know it meant that. So every translation is an interpretation of the text. You're going to another language in another time. Just like the NAB likes to use the word handmaiden. Scholars say, well, the word really is slave. We don't like the word slave. Don doesn't like the word slave. Most people don't like the word slave. Okay? Handmaid sounds much better. It's been sanitized. Okay? But that's an interpretation now to the text. By the translation. It's the same way you gotta keep this in mind when I keep harping on the Septuagint. You probably all think I'm crazy. Why does he keep harping on the Septuagint? Because that was the Greek translation of the Hebrew Scriptures. So they were taking the Hebrew and putting it into Greek. And we believe that the Greek Septuagint is the Word of God. Talk to a Muslim in the Quran and show him an English translation of the Quran and ask him if that's the word of God, and he'll say no. It's only in Arabic. Once you move from Arabic to English or German or Spanish or Italian or whatever, it's not the word of God anymore. But we Jews and Catholics don't believe that. We believe the translation is also the word of God. See what I'm saying? And so you can have words from the book of Isaiah that in Hebrew says, a young maiden in the harem will have a son, and you will name him Emmanuel. The Septuagint uses a word that says, a virgin will have a son, and name him Emmanuel. Now, the fact of the matter is, that young girl in the harem, she better be a virgin. Okay. That's why she's there. Okay. But that's not what the Hebrew word has to be translated as. And if you look at the new version of the NAB, doesn't say virgin there in Isaiah anymore. It says a young maiden. Because they went back to the Hebrew to translate into English, not to the Septuagint. And Jerome went to the Septuagint to translate into the Vulgate. Okay? Not meant to mess up your theology that Mary wasn't a virgin, but this is an example of what I'm talking about. Okay? So sometimes the Septuagint translation of the Hebrew may not have been exactly very literalist translation of that. So they're putting an interpretation on the text. And you're going to see that, for example, when Jesus is in the synagogue and he's reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. It's not the Hebrew version of the words. Jesus is going to translate, it's going to say it, it's going to translate a little bit different. Because it's the Septuagint version. He would never have read the Septuagint version in the synagogue in Nazareth. He would have read the Hebrew version. But there's a difference between the Isaiah quote from Isaiah and the quote in Luke in a couple places. Because that quote is from the Septuagint translation of the Hebrew. Okay. You follow me on that? Translations are interpretations. Subtlety, sometimes. So, okay. You started a fire here.
You know I am.
I know you are.
Is there somewhere that I can get a roadmap to the translation? Yeah. GPS to the translation.
I can't tell exactly where to go now, but I'm going to be ordering a couple books about interpretation and translation probably here pretty soon that I'm going to read. But you know, but you could take an English translation of the Hebrew. I'm sure there must be out there somewhere, and then the English translation of the Septuagint of the same thing, and put them side by side the same way you could take Matthew, Mark, and Luke and put it by each other and see how they differ from one another. You can do that. But, you know, that's getting very, really technical now. From what we want. Okay. And I don't know when that would worry when we go that far. Okay? Now, that gets us to chapter 1. Okay? So we got some time. Who would like to, I think we got through chapter 1, didn't we?
Yeah.
Again, who would like to, Jeff, will you begin chapter 2?
The birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment, when Quirinius was governor of Syria. So all went to be enrolled, each to his own town. And Joseph too went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David that is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. While they were there, the time came for her to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
Okay, stop there for a second. Okay, so what is Luke doing? Luke is putting Jesus' birth in the stable in Bethlehem in terms of the entire Roman Empire. Okay? There would have been propaganda coming out from Rome that would have said the good news was that there was good news on the day that Caesar Augustus was born. Okay? And of course what Luke is saying is something that's very subversive. He's saying the real good news is from this baby in the stable in a manger in Bethlehem is born, not the emperor. Okay? This is the real Lord and Master of the universe in that feeding trough. That's very subversive to the Roman Empire. Okay? Okay, so we got this. We're putting it into context, Caesar Augustus. Okay. Now there was a Roman named Publius Sulpicius Quirinius. That's a mouthful. Was appointed governor of the province of Syria in AD 6. Okay. He had been a legate for a while. He had a couple different functions in Syria. Even though the Gospels were often called Pilate the governor, Pilate's real title was prefect, proconsul. Okay? the governor would have been in Syria of the province. Think of it that way, governors of a province. And Pontius Pilate was prefect of Judea. Romans became prefects in Judea in 6 AD when the son of Archelaus of Herod the Great messed things up so bad the Jews asked him to be replaced. And of course, the Jews were hoping that the Romans would put another Jew in there. Instead, they said, no, we'll send one of our Roman officials. And that's the reason why Jesus gets crucified, because it's a Roman form of execution. Okay? So it's important that this area of Judea, part of entire Palestine, okay, is run by a Roman official, because now Romans are going to use their form of execution to a criminal, subversive person. That kind of thing. Okay. Okay. After Herod's death, I talked about Archelaus. Some Jews found paying taxes directly to Roman overlords offensive. Not many joined. There was a rebellion that went out and things like. Luke seems to date the census and the birth of Jesus to the time when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And this creates a difficulty. Gabriel appeared to Zechariah in the days of Herod. Okay. Herod the Great died about 4 BC. 4 to 2 BC. Jesus is born not much more than 15 months later, well before Quirinius became the actual governor. Okay. And some scholars suggest that verse 2 be translated, this enrollment happened before Quirinius was governor of Syria, to make it fit. Don't worry. Okay. Luke, Quirinius, you know, he's trying to put this into world history. This is a world event, which should not be a world event. The birth of somebody in a backwater town of Bethlehem in Palestine, in Judea, and the baby gets put in a trough in which animals eat out of, would not be thought to be a world event. The birth of a son of Augustus in Rome in the palace would be thought to be a world event. That's the point that we need to think, okay? Okay. Let's see what else. Also, you know, if you had asked a good Jew, what's the city of David? Don, what would they have said?
Bethlehem. No.
Jerusalem. That was the capital. Remember, he conquers Jerusalem. Jerusalem was never part of the heritage. It belonged to the Jebusites. And so David, being the very keen political, astute person he was, conquers this area that was never part of any tribe and makes it the capital of the empire. Okay. So for most Jews, if you would ask them, what's the city of David, they would have said, oh, Jerusalem. He conquered it, but Bethlehem was where it was born. Okay. So that's the point. Okay. Okay. Bethlehem, by the way, lies about 5 miles south of Jerusalem. Okay. The prophet Micah called it too small to be among the clans of Judah, but nevertheless prophesied, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel. Micah chapter 5, verse 1. Micah's prophecy was the basis for an expectation that the Messiah would not only be a descendant of David, but would also come from Bethlehem. But this expectation of a Bethlehem origin was not shared by all at the time of Jesus. From other writings we can tell that. Okay. But Bethlehem was very insignificant, except that David was born there. But they go back, supposedly for the census, they have to go back to where they came from, where their clan was, and so Joseph and Mary go to Bethlehem, and that's how Jesus gets born in Bethlehem, and then that way that satisfies Micah's prophecy of Bethlehem. Okay. Unlike, he shall be called the Nazarene, you know, causes some difficulty. But anyway, he's born in Bethlehem. This is how Luke gets Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem, because normally they were from Nazareth. During Jesus' life, nobody ever calls Jesus of Bethlehem. What do they call him? Jesus of Nazareth. Okay? Because a lot of times, that's why in John's Gospel says, Philip or Bartholomew might say, what good ever came out of Nazareth? It's a poor little farming town. You tell me the Messiah comes from there? You gotta be kidding me. There's nothing in Scripture about that. You know, remember? From John's Gospel. You know, kind of a thing. But anyway, so Mary and Joseph get there, okay? Now, when it says a firstborn son, That's not to imply that there are other born sons. As you remember from my homily on the Holy Family, that relationship between the firstborn son and the mother was very important. The firstborn son was always mommy's boy. Okay? She favored the firstborn son. Also, firstborn sons were holy to the Lord. We're going to find that certain things are going to have to be done. Because you have to redeem the firstborn, don't you? It comes from Torah. Okay? You have all the thing in Torah about if you're not going to redeem your donkey, you got to break its neck, and all, you know, firstborn of all the animals and of all the males that come from the womb belong to the Lord. Therefore, you have to do something to redeem the firstborn. So you offer something in its place. And we're going to see that played out here in a little bit. Okay, what else? In. The Greek word Luke uses is not so specific, and it doesn't mean like a holiday inn or anything like that. Okay? Noni means a place where you might stay. It is translated as guest room in chapter 22, verse 11. You know, where Jesus says, go and find this guest room to celebrate the Passover. It's the same word used there as used here for inn in Greek. Okay. Let's see that. Okay. Of course, caves in Palestine were dank, dreadful accommodations. They were used to shelter humans as well as animals, even unto modern times. Nevertheless, birth in a cave with a feeding trough for a cradle is hardly a mark of exalted social status. Jesus, who will lift up the lowly, was born into this world as one of his lowly ones. Again, the baby in that trough is the real Lord and Master of the universe, not Caesar Augustus. Back in okay. You want to pick up from there? I think, we'll talk about some of this other stuff later. Go ahead.
Now, there were shepherds in that region living in the fields and keeping the night watch over their flock. The angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with great fear. The angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Mm-hmm. For today in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Messiah and Lord. Mm-hmm. And this will be a sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly hosts with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests.
Okay, just a little bit more about that. These are shepherds. Shepherds, not a very good occupation to have, shepherd. But this fits in with the whole gospel. It's one of the themes of Luke, the reversal. The have-nots become the haves, huh? The has become the have-nots. The first will be last. The last will be first. Jesus is born into this poor situation. The people that come to him in Luke's gospel are not those magi, Persian, priests and stuff. They're the lowly shepherds and stuff. Okay, and he's going to appeal. This is Luke's gospel, very much the gospel of the poor. Huh? That kind of a thing. Okay, that was just a low occupation, a low status occupation. Okay. We talked about the city of David. Lord and Messiah. Messiah, meant anointed. God's anointed one. The priests were anointed. Prophets were anointed. Priests were, kings were anointed. Things like that. Okay? Caesar Augustus would have thought he was Lord and God's favorite. Okay? And Luke is saying, no. He's not. This baby is. And very subversive. Okay? And, of course, being born into this low status, seemingly, and yet being who he is, really, shows kind of the paradox of his life, too. Okay. Of course, host, again, we talked about, means army. Okay. And by having the angels and stuff, it's Luke's version of the star, isn't it? He's saying there's cosmic things going on here at Jesus' birth. For Luke, he's going to have a host of angels singing in the heights. Matthew's going to have a star that's going to lead the Magi to Jesus and stuff like that. So they're both set in cosmic things. So let's go ahead and just stop there. We're coming up to about 8 minutes to go before our time is up for tonight. So let me go ahead and then bring up something, and if some of you want to take some of these handouts, you can. I'm going to ask for my lovely assistant. In case you want a bibliography, before the reader has a bibliography. I mentioned to somebody at the break, after I had been a priest for 5 years, the seminary has what they call pre-study days at Blessed John the 23rd. And so about 9 or 10 of us from my class went back to Western Massachusetts, because our class was being honored. And they have a guest speaker come in. And it happened to be Father Donald Sr. Father Sr. is a renowned American biblical scholar. In fact, he's on the Pontifical Biblical Commission. Okay? And he gave a talk. And guess who talked about?
Jewish.
Okay? And he gave us a handout to help you. It's Luke's Gospel and the Reading Cycle for Year 6. So can I ask my other beautiful okay. And so you might want to look at that when you come to Mass for the weekend, because this is going to tell you if you want to hear Mass on certain weekends of the liturgical year. And I've got a couple other things that I'm going to do too. But the last thing I want to end with today's talk about is this idea of the Word of God. Dei verbum. Now, those of you who have been in my Old and New Testament class got a copy of Dei verbum. So you don't need to pick up another one. The Word of God. And you know, for us Catholics, the Word of God is both sacred scripture and sacred tradition. But it has a section in there about sacred scripture. And a lot of the things that was in Dei Verbum actually came from writings of the Pontifical Biblical Commission that had been regenerized around the same time as Vatican II. Okay? And in the writings of the Pontifical Biblical Commission, and therefore in Dei Verbum, and there are some copies up here if you want to take a Dei Verbum, if you don't have one, if you want one, that's fine. There's also kind of a shortened version called How the Gospels Were Written by Father Foley that I've given that in other classes if you want that. And there's another one about how to understand the Bible, kind of a thing.
You're short.
You're short?
Yeah.
Okay. Well then let me tell me how many you got in need.
Oh, no, we don't need two.
See, what happened was 12 of you signed up for the class. Ahead of time. And I got the names too, Barbara. Okay, what we'll do is next week I'll bring 12 copies of that. And did everybody get the thing from Senior, Donald Senior? Okay. So you can have that when you go to Mass on the weekend. Same thing, if you want Dei Verbum and you run out of them, you just write on a slip of paper, I need Dei Verbum, or I want to think about the three stages of development of the Gospels, we can do that too. Because I just didn't want to make like 100 copies and find out nobody showed up for class.
Mm, yeah.
So, okay. But if you remember from the Mark class, and if you remember from the overview of the Old and New Testament classes, the Catholic Church believes that the Gospels were developed in three stages. Okay. Stage one, was the actual events, right? Jesus Christ, what he said, what he did, he suffered, he died, he loved, Mark plus Q plus little Luke, okay? They had these things that they could put into and write down that became the Gospels. And so they're not necessarily writing down things in terms of the absolute God-honest chronology of how the events occurred, okay? We're going to see next week that Luke begins Jesus' public life out by him going to Nazareth and standing up and reading from the scroll of Isaiah, which occurs in chapter 6 of Mark. Okay? He's moved it up front for a particular reason. Okay? And we'll talk about what some of those reasons might be. So they're not necessarily in the same, in the actual chronological order that they happen. Okay? They're going to pick and choose what they want to present to their audience, because they know that their audience has a certain background. Okay? If you're Matthew, you're writing to a very Jewish audience, so you want to talk about things in terms of Jewish idioms. Mark, coming, maybe a mixed bag of people, and blah, blah, blah. And then Luke, Greco-Roman. They're not probably interested in hand-washing controversies or anything to them. Okay? Or Luke's going to change the story, because there's going to be a story about this paralytic that his four friends climbed up the little rope ladder on the side of the house, then dug the thatched roof off and put him down in front of Jesus, remember? Luke's going to say they took the tiles off the roof. Why? Because the people he's writing to have tile roofs. Okay? So each of the evangelists are going to tell the story in a little different way, and they're going to adapt the story to their audience. Plus the fact they're writing in Greek. And as we mentioned before, Jesus spoke in Aramaic. So automatically, these are not the exact words of Jesus, unless, like Mark, he records the Aramaic words. Talithakum, that is, little girl, arise. Okay? There's the Greek, there's the Aramaic words. That was the words of Jesus, you know? Other than that, none of those words technically are the exact words of Jesus. They're in Greek now. Okay? They're written for an audience, to play with that audience and stuff like that. Now, having said that, everything is absolutely reliable in the gospel. We're not saying that anything is not reliable. Okay? But the message went through these three stages of development. And Dave Verbum talks about them, that little handout Catholic Update talks about the three stages. If you've not gotten it before, if you've been in my courses, you've gotten this thing. So you know that. If you've never been in one, it would really help to read either Dave Verbum. You can always get it on the internet, just Google Dave Verbum. In the Latin words, the Word of God. Okay? The Second Vatican Council spoke of the inspired meaning of Scripture in terms of the meaning expressed by the authors of the biblical books. Since therefore all that the inspired authors or sacred writers affirm should be regarded as affirmed by the Holy Spirit, was acknowledged that the books of Scripture firmly, faithfully, and without error teach that truth which God, for the sake of our salvation, wished to see confided to the sacred Scriptures. So that's the kind of background, and that's the reason why we Catholic interpretation of the Bible is not that very literalist Bible Belt interpretation of the Bible. Because they get very, very upset if everything is this word means this, plus this word means this, plus this word, and therefore it means this. And we're saying, not really. Okay. And they're saying, yeah. Then I say, well, how come it says in another place this plus this plus this, which doesn't say that, but they're talking about the same thing. Then you get silence. Okay. It's like, did David kill Goliath? There's another place in the Bible that says David's lieutenant killed Goliath. Okay. Okay. Only one of the two could have killed him. Okay. There are those things like that. Doesn't matter. Okay. Ultimately, necessary for salvation is what's inerrant, what's inspired. And you hear that addressed in David Verbum. And in a little article on the three stages of the development of the Gospels. Okay. And that's probably enough for one night. We'll pick up reading again. Okay? And we'll work our way through Scripture as best we can. We'll try to read it all. We get Don to get his voice back and stay with us. So I want to end with a little prayer, huh? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
You're welcome.
I'm going to get out of here.